Victory!
Hi! Welcome to Victory!
Hi, welcome to Victory!
Good morning.
We're the Blizzards.
Welcome to Victory Church.
Want you, Lord.
like never before. Your presence is an open door. So come now, Lord, like never before. We worship you, oh God. We know that you are there. We know breakthrough is coming. We know revival is coming. We're worshiping you in our living rooms. We're worshiping you in our homes. We're worshiping you in our cities. We're giving you praise. We're giving you worship. We're giving you praise. You deserve the highest praise. You deserve the highest praise. I know breakthrough is coming. By faith, I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and it won't stop now. I know breakthrough is coming. By faith, I see a miracle. My God made me a promise.
Your faithfulness. Thank you, Lord. Romans chapter 8 gives us this wonderful promise about the faithful love of God. It says this in verse 35, can anyone, anything ever separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean that he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity or are persecuted or hungry or destitute or in danger or threatened with death? Verse 37 says, no, despite all of these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loves us. And I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love, neither death nor life nor angels or demons, or our fears for today, or our worries about tomorrow. Not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below, indeed nothing in all creation, will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Isn't that something to give thanks for? Thank you, Lord, for your love. We celebrate that. We rest in that in Jesus' name.
No height, no depth can separate. Your steadfast love can escape. Your faithfulness and endless sea. So full of grace and mercy. And we say God is so so good. God is so good. He's so good to me.
Yes, Lord.
good, so good. And I'm haunted by the past no more. My innocence has been restored. Forgiveness flows from your veins. Your kindness shown in all your ways. And we sing, God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me.
Sing it again. You gotta sing it.
Sing, God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me.
There's never been.
There's never been anyone like you. There's never been anyone like you. You are worthy. You are worthy. There's never been anyone like you. There's never been anyone like you. You are worthy. God, you are worthy.
Sing again.
Oh, there's never been anyone like you. There's never been anyone like you. You are worthy. You are worthy. Oh, there's never been anyone like you. There's never been anyone like you. You are worthy. You are worthy. And hope is rising like the sun. The old is gone, the new has come. And I fix my eyes on Christ alone. I rock my shield, my cornerstone. And we say, God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. Sing, God, you're so good.
Yes, you are,
God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me. There's never been anyone like you. There's
so good.
We sing, God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to
thank you.
crushing, in the pressing, you are making new wine. In the soil I now surrender, you are breaking new ground. So I yield to you into your careful hand. When I trust you, I don't need to understand. Make me a vessel. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. I came here with nothing, but all you have given me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. In the crushing, in the pressing, you are making new wine. In the soil I now surrender, you are breaking new ground. You are breaking new ground. Make me a vessel. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. I came here with nothing, but all you have given me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. 'Cause where there is new wine, there is new power, there is new freedom, and the kingdom is here. I lay down my old place to carry your new fire today. Came here with nothing, but all.
Hi, my name is Brittany. I'm a life group leader here at Victory. Thank you for tuning in and worshiping with us today. If you're a first-time guest, I want to extend a special welcome to you. We hope you discover how much God loves you and the great plans he has for your life. On your phone, right now, you can go to getvictory.net/connectcard or text CONNECT to 610-894-6378. There, you'll find an online Connect card. You can begin completing that now. Regular attenders, please complete a Connect card with your name and your email address. If you're a first-time guest or you've never completed a Connect card before, then let us know whether you're a first, second, or third-time guest, and then give us as much information as you feel comfortable sharing with us. At the end of that online form, there's also a chance to let us know how we can pray for you. Please enter in something you need prayer for. Once you are done completing that online Connect card on your phone, press submit and we will be praying for you this week.
It's my privilege now to lead us in our next act of worship, our giving. We are so grateful for your commitment to the Lord and your generosity. Your giving makes it possible for Victory Church to continue sharing this hope-filled message about Jesus, meet the needs of our surrounding community, and partner with missions and missionaries around the world. There are two easy and secure ways you can give. You can text GETVICTORY to 77977, or you can head over to getvictory.net/give. One more thing. You may be facing some very real practical needs during these unprecedented times. If so, would you please let us know? We would love to work with you to see if we can bring some relief. I invite you to go to getvictory.net/need right now. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your extraordinary love and care for each person that is watching today. You've shown that so beautifully and perfectly through the giving of your Son, Jesus. Bless every person as they give, and I pray that you'd meet every need through Christ Jesus. Amen.
One thing I know about this coronavirus lockdown is this: your life has been disrupted. And I'm sorry to say that it's probably not going to go back to exactly the way it was before this lockdown, before this disruption. But I have hope, because while so many things are locked down, our God is not locked down. He's still at work, and he's working in this disruption to bring some change to all of our lives. And I so believe in the power of disruption. I've experienced that myself. In fact, 40 years ago, I had a major life-changing disruption. It was a 16-week lockdown, not a quarantine because of any kind of sickness, but a lockdown because in April 1980, 40 years ago this month, I reported for basic training in the United States Army, followed by 8 weeks of training for being a military police. So that was a big disruption, and it brought about some changes that I desperately wanted in my life. It took this misguided college dropout. I dropped out because I knew that I wasn't making the grades that I wanted to make, that I needed to make to fulfill my goals. I was partying too much, taking too many drugs, just not doing what I knew was in me to do. So I needed the disruption that the Army would bring to take me from that college dropout status to becoming a disciplined soldier for whom there was at least some chance of getting in the right direction. So I believe that the power of disruption that is taking place right now can bring some very positive change to our own lives. See, I wanted to make a big life change back in those college days, but I just couldn't. I needed the disruption and the discipline of the Army to bring about the changes that I wanted to make. And I'm sure there are some changes that you want to make. There are some ways that your life is stuck and you need a disruption to just move you forward into God's plan, into God's destiny for your life. And I believe that if we'll take the situation we're facing right now and put it over into God's hands, that he'll work some very positive change into each one of our lives. Romans 12:2 says this: "Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. One translation says, don't be squeezed into the world's mold. Don't be squeezed into the world's mold. Most of the time, we allow ourselves to be pressed into the patterns of this world because that's just the natural way of things in life all around us. It's as though we're a fish in water and we're just swimming in the environment in which we find ourselves, unaware that we're in water. We're unaware of the patterns of our culture because we naturally just fit in. But right now, do you know what's happening? The cultural molds are being broken. Patterns of this world are being broken, and it's an opportunity for us, once we're trying to find some new patterns, to find patterns that are shaped after God's word, patterns that are shaped after the expectation for God to move powerfully in our lives, patterns that fit an expectation that God is sending a great awakening, and he's going to do through us as a church and through us as individuals what only God can do. So we're going to be looking for some new patterns because the old patterns are broken. Let's make sure that when we find those new patterns, they're not just worldly patterns, but godly patterns. Hebrews chapter 12 gives us hope that God will use hardship to help us be all that God has called us to be. And you're going to get through this hardship. I know you will. And you'll come through a changed person if you invite God to do his work during this time of disruption. Let's get a look at Hebrews chapter 12, beginning with verse 4, and we're going to get some principles of allowing this disruption to get us unstuck out of some old patterns that just weren't getting us where we wanted to go. So, verse 4 of Hebrews 12. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. And have you completely forgotten this word of encouragement that addresses you as a father addresses his son? It says, my son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline, and do not lose heart when he rebukes you. It's important right now that we not make light of the situation, nor lose heart in this situation. Why? Because the Lord disciplines the one he loves, and he chastens everyone he accepts as his son. Here's the key verse. We'll be looking at it very much in depth in this message. Endure hardship as discipline. God is treating you as his children. For what children are not disciplined by their father? If you are not disciplined, and everyone undergoes discipline, then you are not legitimate, not true sons and daughters at all. But we are true sons and daughters. Moreover, we have all had human fathers who disciplined us, and we respected them for it. How much more should we submit to the Father of spirits and live? They disciplined us for a little while as they thought best, but God disciplines us for our good, in order that we may share in his holiness. No discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it. Therefore, strengthen your feeble arms and weak knees. Make level paths for your feet, so that the lame may not be disabled, but rather healed. Like I said, verse 7 is really key there. Endure hardship as discipline. Endure hardship as discipline. Now, it doesn't say endure hardship as punishment. Punishment is mentioned in this passage, but we don't endure hardship as punishment. We endure it as discipline. The discipline of basic training in the army is not punishment. Sometimes there might be a little bit of punishment. If I got out of line, the drill sergeant might say, Crenshaw, drop and give me 10, and I have to do 10 push-ups. But if we were just doing physical training and the drill sergeant said, drop and give me 10, then that would have just been a matter of discipline, helping us to be trained as lean, green, mean fighting machines. That was the intention. So discipline is not about punishment. Punishment might come into play, but this is about the change that God wants to bring about in our lives. So Hebrews 12 tells us to endure hardship as discipline. Discipline. God is disciplining us. That is, he's shaping us and changing us, molding us. I don't believe that God sent the coronavirus. I don't believe it is a punishment from God, but I think if we will put it back into his hands, he will use it to shape and direct and change our lives for the good. When you think about it, John 10:10 says it's the thief who comes to kill and steal and destroy, but Jesus came that we might have life and have it to the full. So it's not God's job to kill, steal, destroy. It's not God's job to send sickness and disease. I don't believe that God did it, but I believe that we can put it into God's hands, and he will use this time. And I want to encourage you, make every opportunity, take every opportunity that this time affords to let God do a fresh new work. Like I said, the molds have been broken, and it's time for some new molds that fit God's pattern. The second part of verse 7 says, God is treating you as children. We who are parents have disciplined our children, right? Why did we discipline our children? Why do we discipline our children if we have children at home now? It's because we want to raise them up so that they have wisdom, so that they can make right choices, so that they can choose a path of blessing for their lives. It's because we want good for our children. And God is the same way. If he disciplines us, and he does, it's because he wants good for our lives. That means that sometimes God's desire to shape and direct your life has more influence on what he does for you than his desire to make it easy on you. What do I mean by that? I mean that God is not always as concerned about making it easy on you as he is concerned about changing you. God is not always as concerned about changing your circumstances as he is concerned about changing you. And sometimes that means that hardship lasts a little bit longer or is resolved a little bit differently than we might have liked. But God is using it to shape and mold our character. It's going to work. It's going to do some awesome things in our lives. So I want to ask a couple of questions here. First question is, what do you need to change? If God is using hardship to change you, to discipline you, to get you on a new path, to get you to fit some new patterns, what do you need to change? I know a lot of you would probably like for me to point my finger at you and tell you exactly what you need to change. Yeah, I see you there. I know what you, no, I don't know. I have no idea, and I have no way of knowing, just preaching to a camera, whether you're laughing or whether you're frowning, I don't know. I don't know a lot of things, but I know this, God knows what you need. God knows what you need to change, and I want to encourage you, just ask God. Ask God, how do I need to change? What do I need to change in my life? You might want to do as King David did, who was bold enough to say, God, search me and see if there are any offensive or wicked ways in me. Let me know what's wrong, God. Well, I believe that God will let you know what you need to change. And this just popped in my head. If God won't let you know what needs to be changed and you're married, your spouse will let you know. No, I'm kidding. Just kidding. Ask God. Ask God if there are priorities that you need to shift. Ask God if you need to change in some of the ways that you relate to other people in your life. Ask God if there are some changes you need to bring in the way you relate to your spouse or to your children or to your parents or to your coworkers or your fellow students or your neighbors. Ask God if there are some changes you need to make in your relationships. Ask God if there are some changes you need to make in your character. The plan of God is for you to live in his holiness, as this passage said. Ask God if there are some changes you need to make with what you're doing with your life. Ask God if there are some changes you need to make in your relationship with him. If there are some changes you need to make in terms of being who God called you and made you to be. Ask God if there are some changes you need to make in terms of what you are doing to fulfill his call on your life, to obey his call on your life. Ask God. And I'll tell you this, if you're a follower of Jesus, praise God, I can guarantee you, you are not who or what you used to be. Hallelujah. He has marvelously transformed your life. It's amazing. Don't downplay that. But as they say, God is not finished with us yet. No one of us has arrived yet. As long as we're still on this earth, we still need to change. So, here's the second question. First question, what do you need to change, or how do you need to change? Second question, how much do you need to change? Because sometimes we might think we've come so far that we don't really need to change much more. How much do you need to change? Let me put it to you this way. How much more would you need to change to be exactly like Jesus? And you know, Romans tells us that our destiny is to be conformed to the image of Jesus. We're supposed to be like him. How much more would you need to change to be just like Jesus? Well, I can tell you this. There's an infinite distinction between us and Jesus. We still have an infinite amount of change to experience. So that's a long way. Wherever we are in our spiritual walk and in our spiritual maturity, there's a lot of change to be experienced. So might as well embrace it and go for it. And if it means embracing hardship as discipline, that's what's producing change, let's do it, because there's a lot more change to go. Third question, what do you get out of it? You might not really want to ask that question, because a lot of times we think, well, I just serve God because I want to serve God. But let me tell you, God has arranged things so that when you serve and follow him, when you let him shape and change and direct your life, there are some benefits. Doesn't mean everything goes easy. We're talking about hardship. We're talking about discipline. We're talking about going through tough times. Those times will still come, but there is a benefit on the other side of obeying God. Well, we find that in verse 11. Here's what you get out of it. Verse 11 says, no discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. So I'm not promising you freedom from pain. Later on, however, this is the result. It produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it. We embrace hardship as discipline because God wants us to move forward toward a harvest of righteousness and peace. What is a harvest of righteousness? It doesn't just mean that you're going to be more righteous. It means that there is a harvest that flows out of righteousness. There's a harvestness that flows out of you being in right connection with God. There's a harvest that flows out of you being rightly aligned with God, his plan for your life, his will for your life. When you are rooted in that, letting him change you, change your character, there is going to be a harvest of righteousness. That's why James says that the prayers of a righteous man are powerful and effective. That's part of that harvest. And if you go back and read Isaiah 32, it talks some more about that. I'm not going to take the time to look into that, but there are some verses there that talk specifically about a harvest of righteousness and the blessings that come from living a righteous life. Just think about it. Living rightly with God is going to produce something powerful in your life. Not necessarily freedom from all pain, because God's going to continue to use pain to shape us, but he's going to produce an amazing harvest. And the other thing that it says in Hebrews results from this discipline, as we've been trained by hardship, is peace. Who couldn't use a little more peace? See, peace doesn't come by all the circumstances of your life being perfect. Peace comes by being whole in your relationship with God. Peace comes through God, through his presence in your life, so that you can have peace in any storm. Hallelujah. We need peace right now, and he wants to give it to you. Three things then that we've talked about that you need to know. Get this rooted in you. One is, you are a beloved child of God. You're a child of God. He loves you. He's your heavenly Father. Number two, you will receive a harvest of righteousness. And number three, you will walk in peace. But this passage that we've read points to six things that I think we have a responsibility for, and I want to walk you through those very quickly. Here's responsibility number one. Respect your heavenly Father. Verse 9, first part of that says, moreover, we have all had human fathers who disciplined us, and we respected them for it. We respected our human fathers who disciplined us, who wanted us to have a better life. God, our Heavenly Father, is worthy. He's not just worthy of respect. He's worthy that we honor Him. He's worthy of our worship. He's worthy that we would bow our lives before Him. The Bible tells us that if we humble ourselves before Him, He's going to lift us up. It's amazing. He's worthy of our worship, and that ties in with the second responsibility that we have. First, respect our Heavenly Father. Number two, submit to Him and live. The last part of verse 9 says, how much more should we submit to the Father of spirits and live? That requires a little bit of humility. Submission requires humility. We bow our lives before God, and as I said, He lifts us up. Jesus said that if we lose our lives for Him and for the gospel, we're going to really find life. We submit to Him and we live. That's life. That's living. That's what we want to experience in our relationship with God. So respect for our Father. Submit and live. Third responsibility, be trained by this hardship, this discipline. Verse 11, last part of that verse says, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace, which we talked about as the reward. For whom? For those who have been trained by it. Don't be the kind of person who has to go through an experience over and over and over and over again and not get the lesson. If you find yourself continuously stuck and patterns being repeated, patterns where, you know, it's to your detriment, and you just find yourself in that hole time and time again, it's time to ask God, what lesson am I not getting? And I'm not saying that all hardship comes because, you know, we haven't learned our lesson, but if we find something just repeatedly being experienced over and over, maybe there is a lesson for you in that particular area. Be trained by it. That's something that we have to accept, that we have to embrace, that hardship's not just happening and we're not just being fatalistic about it. Oh, whatever will be, but we are allowing ourselves to be trained by it. The fourth thing is don't give up. That's the thrust of the entire letter to the Hebrews, because there were a lot of Jewish people who were wondering, is this following of the Messiah worth it all? They were losing things. They were losing status. They were beginning to be persecuted. They had not yet been persecuted to the point of shedding of blood, but they were going through it, and they were wondering, is it worth it? And the lesson of this, back to verse 7, is endure hardship as discipline. Endure. Stick with it. It's worth it. Stick with it. Verse 11, no discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. But in spite of the pain, hold on. When I was in basic training, I developed a severe case of shin splints, so painful that when I stepped out of the bed in the morning, the bunk as they would call it, I would be in such excruciating pain that tears would come to my eyes, but I was not about to quit because I had already been through 3 or 4 weeks of basic training and I wasn't going to start all over again. So I just stuck with it. Now I can tell you this in terms of ministry. My family and I have gone through seasons of such pain. Such pain, I don't even want to talk about it, don't want to think about it, but such pain, I've wondered, God, can I make it? Can I continue? I don't want to. I'm telling you, it's been that hard at times, but something inside of me said, Ed, keep on going. Don't quit, don't quit, don't quit. And it's always paid off to keep going on. Don't give up. Whatever you're going through, don't give up. Number 5, strengthen yourself. Verse 12 says, strengthen your feeble arms and weak knees. Yeah, I see those feeble arms and weak knees. No, I'm just kidding. But notice that the writer of Hebrews is encouraging a full body workout. You don't want to just build up your biceps and have, you know, toothpick legs that you just topple over. You need a full body workout. You need to be trained in every respect, in every aspect of your being. Strengthen your feeble arms and weak knees. But notice this. Who's supposed to do the strengthening? You are. Strengthen your feeble arms and weak knees. That implies there's some initiative, there's some responsibility on your part. Strengthen yourself. A lot of times when we're going through troubles, we resort to coping mechanisms that are harmful. Could be too much alcohol, could be, you know, therapeutic shopping, I don't know, eating too much, overindulging in something. We have coping mechanisms, but instead of choosing those old coping mechanisms right now, choose some new habits, positive habits. Get into the Word of God. Make prayer a regular part of your life. Get into those daily disciplines, and I believe that God will begin to use those to shape you in the midst of this major disruption. It'll help you get unstuck like nothing else if you'll just strengthen yourself in the things that God has provided for your strength and health spiritually. Number 6, make level paths. I love this. Verse 13 says, make level paths for your feet. Who are you making level paths for? Yourself, your feet. But notice that it's not just for you. Make level paths for your feet, the verse says, so that the lame may not be disabled, but rather healed. In other words, the path you make for yourself will be followed by somebody else. The path that you level and make smooth for yourself will be followed by somebody else. Now, this is something that we can do so that the lame may either be disabled or healed. That's what the verse says. They'll either be disabled or healed. Somebody's following your path. Will they be disabled or will they be healed? Who's following your path? If you're a parent, your own children are. Other people in your life are looking to you. Your coworkers, those who know that you are a Christian, they're looking to you. Make a level path for yourself, and the lame will follow it and be healed. God wants to use you powerfully. Those are 6 things that I believe God will use to help you get unstuck. I love the fact that right now we are doing some things that we never would have imagined. You know, we've always known that the church doesn't belong just to a building, that the church is not contained by a building. But, you know, we have taken church into our homes like never before. We have embraced worshiping God in our homes like never before. Somebody told me just a few weeks ago that before this coronavirus lockdown, they would watch our streaming services and just watch. But now they're starting to sing along with our online services. That's something that I believe is fresh and new. I believe that's something that's bringing new patterns into our lives. There are so many things that you can do. Let this time of disruption, of the breaking of old worldly patterns, be an opportunity for you to get some new godly biblical patterns. We want to help you with this, but the first step is to submit your life to this Heavenly Father who loves you. Jesus died for you. He died for your sins. He died so that anything that would hinder your being in complete relationship with the Father would be removed from your life. So that when God sees you, He doesn't see your sin and shortcomings. He sees you through the righteousness of His own Son. I want to ask you today, have you received Jesus? Have you said yes to Him? If you have never said yes to the free gift of eternal life through Jesus, now is your time. And I want you to pray this really simple prayer with me. Just say these words, Heavenly Father, I thank you for your love. I thank you for Jesus. I believe He died on the cross. I believe He was raised from the dead, and He is Lord. Be the Lord of my life. Forgive me of my sins. Help me live for you. Change me, God. Change me, God. Thank you for receiving me as one of your own children. Thank you for your love. I love you, Jesus. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, it's very important that you go online right now, getvictory.net/decision, or if you're watching on Facebook or social media, just immediately respond. If there's a group chat going on, respond right now. Let somebody know that you've made that decision for Jesus. In any way, we want to get connected with you. We want to give you a Bible. We have a free Bible that we'll send to you, so make sure you communicate with us. This coming week, we're starting new life groups. We have some new life groups coming online. You can find those at getvictory.net/groups. Go there, find an online life group. We're not going to be meeting in person, but we can meet electronically, and God is doing some wonderful things through our online groups. We continue to reach the world. We're continuing to serve our community. We're continuing to be a blessing in any way that we possibly can. We know that God is going to bring good out of this lockdown situation, and we're trusting God for a great awakening. We're trusting God for a spiritual move that will transform the very nature of America and of the world, and we're glad to be a part of it. We're glad that you're a part of it as well. We look forward to seeing you again in our next online services. Be blessed. Invite somebody to attend with you. Hold a watch party on Facebook. Let's get the good news out there. God is at work. He's up to something, and it's something good. God bless you. We'll see you next time.
Thank you for watching the service with us. Please share this link with your family and friends on social media or by email. You can be alerted when we go live by subscribing to our YouTube channel, Victory Church Philadelphia. If you made a decision for Christ, go to getvictory.net/decision to let us know so we can follow up by sending you a free Bible and some other resources as you begin your journey with God. We believe in an awesome God, so if you need prayer for anything, please go to getvictory.net/prayer to let us know how we can pray for you and your family. Lastly, if you would like to support Victory Church and our mission to reach our world for Jesus, you can donate anytime on our secure website at getvictory.net/give. You're invited to join us next time. Our online services are Sundays at 9:15 and 11:15 a.m. and on Mondays at 7:15 p.m. Thanks and God bless.
How many know a breakthrough is coming?